Chapter 14. Leaving the natural spring, I retrace my steps back to the road and continue walking. Almost immediately, I pause at a little clearing. Still with Yanko in my thoughts, I look upon the place where his house once stood. Yanko's father, confusingly also called Yanko, had lived with Bakayela. He moved out when he got married and built the little wooden house just a few meters further, and opposite from the house of his birth, under two very large and old pear trees. After some years, the father emigrated to Argentina, soon after his son was born. His wife, Dragica, followed a number of years later. When Yanko later tried to join his parents in South America, he was caught attempting to leave the country without permission. For this, he spent a year in prison. When he was released, he was simply allowed to join his parents and emigrated the year after he had enclosed the natural spring. Upon his arrival, he was to meet his father for the first time. By the mid-1960s, Torna Domšić's grandfather Marko was also in Argentina. The ties that existed between neighbours in the village had clearly crossed the Atlantic intact, and it was there, in Buenos Aires, that Marco concluded the deal to buy the empty house, languishing back in Bukovlje, from Yanko for 100,000 dinars. Marco then gave the house to Torna's and his cousin Darko's parents, Ivan and Pero, and to his daughter Rosa he gave money instead. While Yanko is remembered fondly by all those who came into contact with him, Marco's reputation lingers in the memories for quite different reasons. He became the youngest father in the village at the age of 18. It was customary then to give children born out of wedlock the biblical names of Adam or Eve. A little while later, Marco married Dora. In accounts of his life, Adam is rarely mentioned, but a picture of him survives among a group of passengers standing on the raft crossing the river, the Mrežnica. After the last child, Rosa, was born, Marco packed up and headed to Argentina because of the lack of paid work, where he was able to meet up with Yanko and buy the wooden house. I asked one relative, "Was Marco in contact with his family after he left?" "No," came the reply.
"Ne, al on je njoj samo na jedno pismo odgovorio I ovako joj je pisao: Draga Dore."
My auntie Dora often wrote to him, but he replied just once, saying, "Dear Dora, it would be better that you buy a scarf for your head than to waste money on my empty letter." He left three young children, not including Adam, and my father was so good to them. The children would say that he was like a father to them, and not him in Argentina. My father-in-law Tomo often said that when he was also in Argentina and wanted to write a letter home, that he would get Uncle Marco to write it, since he was illiterate. He always wrote on pink writing paper, a love letter which was dictated to him, until he learnt to write for himself. My mother-in-law Dora always suspected that Marco had another family while he was living abroad. It was said how he would roll up a dollar bill like a cigarette and tuck it behind his ear when he went out looking for women.
Cigaretom za uhu. Ovo je on je frkal dolare, tako je pričao tu. Dok je bio mlad, til je dolar za frkati, metni za uho, kao su nekada prije cigaretu tili metni za uho. Tako je on dolare frkal.
He was a handsome man, more handsome than anyone. The Dora was like an old baba, thin and sunken, but very hard working. Only when Dora died did Marco return to Bukovlje, where he spent his last 10 or so years. His final resting place can be found in the cemetery in the village, along with his two sons, Ivan and Pero. But Dora's name is still yet to be inscribed on the family tomb. While Yanko's wooden house is no longer in its original location, those tall yellow flowers that Dragica planted and which mark the end of our land, still come up each year. And close by there is a row of old withering quince trees from their garden that still produces round scented fruit, but these days remain unclaimed. Continuing on my way, I pass under those two large pear trees, their crowns almost linking together and forming a cathedral-like arch straddling the road. There are several such pear trees that one comes across, not just in Bukovlje, but in the nearby region. They have a majesty about them, and one can clearly see where a small piece had been originally grafted onto rootstock. These, it is said, are the last few survivors that were planted by French soldiers of the Napoleonic army, and this would make them about 200 years old. Soldiers were once garrisoned here in what were then the Illyrian provinces. For just a few years at the beginning of the 19th century, this region was on the furthest fringes of the Napoleonic Empire. In summer months they still produce fruit, but they tend to be small and hard, and usually fall to the ground before they are edible. However, they are not wasted, for they are gathered up off the road and later distilled into brandy. The presence of French soldiers on Croatian soil was short-lived, and while their presence in neighbouring Slovenia is reflected in the roads, bridges and fortresses, if the village stories are to be believed, Napoleon's army is remembered here for the trees that they planted, leaving an enduring legacy. Whatever their origin, it is without doubt that they command a special presence in the village. Standing sentinel as they do, they are like the last loyal subjects of an old guard, who remained behind and are just waiting, biding their time. At the top of the hill, before the road was tarmacked, the track divided, with equal weight given to each branch. A small triangular patch of grass filled the middle space, but when the road was laid, it took preference in one direction and swerved to the left. And this is deceptive, as it stopped short after just a few metres, and some 30 metres from the last house in the village. The council, in its wisdom to save on the expense, decided not to take the road right up to Mara's house, but left it where it remains as a metalled road. This also peters out and becomes a track, negotiable only by tractor. Regrettably, the people laying the road, once they had reached this triangle, decided to push whatever excess aggregate they had into what was a dew pond, just on the edge of this junction. This in turn stifled the water flow from a natural source, so that these days the dew pond only partially fills with water in late winter or early spring. This might be considered a trivial matter, but these days it is the only source of open water left at our end of the village, where frogs used to thrive. This is one of the highest points, yet it displays a kind of geological curiosity, and this was particularly evident at Mara's house. As she told me, when she and her husband built the house, they were digging in the courtyard a hole in which to create a kishnica, an underground tank in which they could collect and store rainwater, until at one point the hole in which they had dug started to fill with water. So instead of the proposed rainwater tank, they simply installed a hand pump into the level where groundwater could be reached. Standing near Tamara's house, I'm always struck by the stunning views from up here and the sweeping panorama stretching out towards Slovenia. The scene below is sparsely populated. A few red roofs of houses help break up the green monotony. But then the eye is ultimately drawn further to a distant rocky outcrop known as Klek. It is a vast natural monument seen from all directions and from great distances, overshadowing a largely wooded landscape. Timber is one of the chief industries, and in the past many villages had their own timber mill, which cut to size the thick planks that built many of the wooden houses hereabouts. After a short rest, I walk back to the junction. Now, this gives me an opportunity to collect some of the wild blackberries that seem to thrive at this spot. The brambles have now obscured access to the dew pond, which is gradually silting up. But in recent years, I have attempted to clear the space around this watering hole and open it up again. Ponds like this were once vital and were a regular stop-off point for cattle as they were led to and from pasture. Following the second arm of the road and stepping off the smooth black surface, the textures underfoot are much more pronounced and irregular. We are now back on the type of track that once characterized all of the tracks in the village. This part is negotiable only by tractor, and while there are many boulders impeding passage, this short stretch links the two roads at our end of the village. The track's twists and turns have an intimate scale and slow the pace of travel. Glimpses of the landscape can be gleaned through gaps around each bend, even though on either side it is considerably overgrown. And an abandoned footpath slinks off and buries itself further in the undergrowth. No road traffic would attempt to navigate this track, but I am on foot. On my right, a field arches down from the brow of the hill and out of sight. The soil is poor here, and the rows of sweet corn hardly reach a dignified height, but the view is nevertheless fantastic. As the track inclines upwards, skirting a deep depression on the left, branches from overcrowding trees yield, and a house appears to the left, bathed in the morning light. This empty wooden house, in which the irises in the little fenced garden still flower. I find it quite remarkable that even after so many years, one can still see such traces of the work of past inhabitants. The house was up for sale some years ago, and I took the opportunity to view the interior, where I found a bundle of photographs lodged in a drawer that, after considerable effort, eventually yielded. Among them I found faces I recognised, though these were the fathers of several neighbours, faces from a different era, from a different regime, betrayed by uniforms and insignia. I also came across a number of pictures of women working in the cotton factory. This factory in the nearby town of Dugoresa employed many people from all the surrounding villages. But that pretty much came to a stop when the Homeland War of the 1990s reached this part of Croatia.